people on stage. I want to introduce everybody first. 135-pound champion. We have to go champion in recess. Is that even, I don't even know what that is anymore. Devin Haney.
You definitely don't have to say recess.
You're the champ. As you said against Ryan Garcia, you're the champ. I'm the champ. Stand Eddie Hearn, Matchroom Boxing USA promoter. Joseph Parker, former heavyweight champion, fighting on this card on Saturday as he makes his way back into the top shelf of the heavyweight picture. And Joe Markovsky, who's wearing a sweater.
Too tall.
Executive Vice President over at The Zone. Welcome, everybody. Devin, since you're sitting next to me, I'll start with you first. When we last saw you, you've talked about, you know, a comeback coming soon. What's the latest with your health, and when can we expect you back in the ring?
I'm getting closer and closer to being back in the ring. I'm looking at early July for me to make my next appearance in the ring.
You were at the fight with Ryan Garcia, confronted him afterwards in the ring. What did you make of all that?
Oh, you know, we're just still building up the fight. I think that's a fight that a lot of the fans would love to see. And it's getting closer and closer to happening. And we're just going to keep building it and keep building it. And sooner or later, it will happen.
Eddie, I think everybody agrees that Devin Haney has the potential to be a pound-for-pound type star. How do you build him into one of those mainstream type of stars?
Well, I think he's getting there. You know, from when he joined us and joined The Zone, I think his profile has risen incredibly. Of course, a couple of great victories as well. And there's no harder worker outside of the ring. I'm not even talking about in the gym, but I'm talking about building his profile, building his brand, understanding what it takes on the promotion side than Devin Haney. We say in England, he would go to the opening of an envelope, you know? And that's what he'd do to push himself, to grow, to learn. And him and Bill do a great job. The great thing about Devin Haney is at 21 years of age, most people would say him and Ryan Garcia, wow, that can be built into a super fight. These guys have so much confidence and so much belief. There's no building to do. That fight for me should come in November, December. We believe that The Zone and Joe would get behind that fight. They're gonna have to get their checkbook out, which we know they'll do for these big fights. But for me, Devin Haney against Ryan Garcia is a super fight, and I really hope we get that. I think Devin's gonna be boxing around June, July time. I think Ryan Garcia may go on the Canelo card. After that, let's just do it. Let's just roll into a huge fight. They're willing to take the risk, and I think fans will respect two outstanding young fighters getting in the ring at such an early stage in their career.
All right, Eddie, you mentioned a super fight that could be in place with Devin and Ryan. One that I think everybody wants to see right away is based on what we saw last weekend. Tyson Fury knocking out Deontay Wilder. He wins the WBC version of the belt. Your guy, Anthony Joshua, has the other three versions of that belt after beating Andy Ruiz. What did you think of Tyson's performance, and how likely is it that we see a unification fight between those two at some point this year?
I think that's inevitable. I mean, firstly, you know, 3 months ago, PBC, America had all the heavyweight belts, and now Great Britain has all the heavyweight belts in Tyson Fury and Anthony Joshua. The conversations have been ongoing. I spoke to Bob Arum probably half an hour ago. I think the biggest issue to sort out now is Deontay Wilder. You know, if there's a deal to be done where Deontay Wilder makes way for a Joshua Fury undisputed fight, we are absolutely all in for that fight. We're closing and just recently closed a couple of minutes ago the Pulev fight for June 20, but we know that Pulev is also promoted by Bob Arum. So there is a deal that can be worked there. For me, you know, if there's no step aside, if you like, let Wilder and Fury go again in July. We'll box on June 20th, and then we can agree now, we can sign now for the undisputed fight in December of this year.
Joe Markovsky, you worked so hard last year to try to get Deontay Wilder and Anthony Joshua into the ring. Does a Tyson Fury Joshua fight excite you as much?
Absolutely, it's the biggest fight arguably in world boxing. To Eddie's point, British heavyweights going at it, it's huge globally. Tyson Fury's done a hell of a job promoting himself in the US. Incredible performance last weekend, and that fight's huge globally, especially in the US and the UK, for sure.
And Joe Parker, you were sitting ringside for that fight in Las Vegas. Give me your impressions about what you saw.
It was a fantastic performance by Tyson Fury. It was no secret, you know, he said he was going to come out, push him back and throw punches and get him out of there. So I think he was telling the public that he was going to knock him out round two. When I went and saw him, he said around six or seven. So
what did you think of those tactics, Gary? I thought it was madness.
I didn't think he was going to, you know, execute it, but it was madness, you know. He was fighting fire with fire. It was a great job by him.
You obviously shared the ring with Anthony Joshua. You know Tyson Fury well, haven't just watched him. How do you think a fight like that goes?
Go on, be honest.
Yeah, be honest. Listen, I think it'll be a great fight. I think it's a fight that we should make happen. I think everyone wants to see who the best heavyweight in the world is. And, you know, I've decided on Fury on that one. Sorry, team.
Tough things to say. I'm curious, Joe, you suffered your first loss in a fight with Anthony Joshua. Deontay just suffered his first loss. From a fighter's perspective, I mean, how difficult is that to get past?
It's not, you know, when you go out there, you've given everything in camp and you've given everything in the ring. Like, at the time, you just have to accept it. I think acceptance and build on it and come back stronger. And I think Deontay should take some time off, relax with his family, come back stronger.
Devin, you're undefeated, but what do you think of the mindset that seems to be throughout boxing right now? Everybody seems to be determined to protect that record. Sometimes when it stops big fights from being made.
Yeah, with boxing now, the always almost the most important thing, and something I don't like is that once you take a loss, that the boxing fans seem to count you out, and that's not what it should be about. It should be about the best fighting the best, the best fights happening, and if you take a loss, it's okay, but being able to bounce back and understand that someone put on a great fight and to not count them out.
Yeah, and look, we have a fight happening April 17th that kind of reflects that. You have Regis Progray and Maurice Hooker Eddie, two guys that have taken losses in the last year. But both still top-tier guys. I mean, no belts on the line in a fight like that, but I think that's the kind of fight that boxing needs. You know, two elite top five fighters in that weight class, you know, going at it without a belt.
Yeah, and I think that's a good example of where the belt doesn't matter. You know, you've got two guys that were former world champions, both attempted to unify, both fell short, and now the actual unified champions are in mandatory bouts that no one wants to see. So these guys kind of take the bull by the horns and say, no, well, let's us fight. And let's us establish ourselves as the major player in the division. Regis Progray against Mo Hooker is a great fight. He's a man that one day might be fighting the winner of those when he moves up to 140 inevitably at some time. And it's a great 50-50 pick and fight. Regis Progray is coming off a fight of the year contender against Josh Taylor, having just lost narrowly, and jumped straight back into a 50-50 fight. Most guys, and sometimes this frustrates us, and especially the broadcaster, where a guy will say, yeah, we want a comeback fight, we want a warm-up fight. No one wants to watch warm-up fights. Fans, even me, especially the broadcaster. Sometimes we understand that they're part of the game. But for guys that are willing to go from big fight to big fight to big fight, they get the respect of their fans, they put bums on seats, people want to tune in to watch them. And you know, if they're good enough, they're going to get right back to the top of the tree ASAP.
Joe, I imagine you agree with Eddie that broadcaster is not a big fan of the warm-up fight.
Well, I look forward to reminding you about that statement in a couple of months' time. I'm sure we'll have an opportunity to do that.
Just to let you know, Devin's having a warm-up fight.
No, it's true. Look, it's about building a career, of course, but from our perspective, we're about putting together the best schedule of fights, making these guys in the biggest fights we can make for them, and delivering a schedule for our subscribers that gives them value for money. That's what we're about.
So you mentioned the schedule. I mean, you're a big fan of the fight season, as we saw at the end of 2019. We've had some fights announced in the last couple of weeks. What do you think about how it's shaping up in the first half of the year for DAZN?
I think from May onwards, we're going to have a really strong schedule. I think we're building into it right now with a fight. This is a fantastic weekend, sort of get our appetites wet for that. And I think through the summer months, the end of the year, you're going to see us make some absolutely huge fights, looking very, very good from May onwards.
Would you both like to update us on Canelo Alvarez and what's happening in those negotiations?
This is a drink me and Joe will have after this weigh-in. But from our point of view, you know, we have two guys in Billy Joe Saunders and Callum Smith, both ready to take that fight. Golden Boy have the numbers that it takes to make those fights happen. You know, from a promotional point of view, as a promoter, you would want to get the opponent for the best price possible. It's part of the business. And from Canelo and Eddie Reynoso's point of view, you want the guy that you want to step in the ring with. So whether those two can be the same person, we'll see, but I think 9 weeks out this Saturday, Canelo Alvarez, none of my business, but I'm guessing we'll be making a decision on his opponent this weekend.
Joe, are you feeling as optimistic as Eddie this is going to get worked out soon?
I think very optimistic about that. I think we're days away from doing that. I do need a drink with Eddie after this, maybe with Frank Smith as well. He's probably slightly better with the numbers than Eddie, but yeah, absolutely. I think we're days away from doing that, and we're excited to get going with that promotion.
Joe Parker, for a number of years, maybe a decade even, the heavyweight division was kind of boring. I mean, you had Vladimir Klitschko at the top of it, not a lot of top guys to compete with him. Now, it just seems like with the Fury win, yourself, Dillian White, Derek Chisora, I mean, so many guys out there. We'll see another fight this weekend. Adam Konofsky's an entertaining fighter. So many guys out there. It seems like this is a really good time to be in the heavyweight division.
I think it's a great time to be a heavyweight. You know, the heavyweight division's on fire. You know, I'm right up there, you know, ranked number two, and I consider myself one of the best in the world, so I have to take care of business this weekend, and then it's up to Eddie to a big fight. Absolutely. So looking forward to it.
But how are you feeling physically? You come off the spider bite, maybe the worst spider bite I've ever heard of, that, you know, cost you a significant fight last year against Eric Tesora. How are you feeling going into this one? And I guess, how do you get back to that top level?
It's a 1-0 to the spider.
He's now got a t-shirt with a spider. I mean, he's, you know, we thought that Jose Parker had the best excuse with the spider bite until Deontay Wilder came along with the ring walk suit, you know. But this was just, from our point of view, just a really depressing moment when this guy had trained so hard for the Chisora fight. It was a perfect fight for him, you know, going back to the UK for what would have been his third fight at the time. And when they called me and said about the spider bite they'd picked up in New Zealand, it was a nightmare. And it was one of those where it sounded like the worst excuse in the world, but was absolutely 1,000,000% true. And so far, so he's taking it well, and he's now a new nickname, and, you know, all his new apparel is branded up with spiders. So, you know, it's just a good sign.
I guess you kind of lean into it, Joe, right?
Yeah, just got to accept it and go with it, you know. But to answer your question, I'm feeling good. I've trained hard off season. I've been in Vegas for 7 weeks training with Kevin and the team. So I'm ready to go out there and perform well.
Eddie, Joe put the pressure on you to get him back into that picture. How do you get Joe Parker back into that top level?
Well, he's top. I mean, he's number two in the WBO. So obviously we have to see what happens with Anthony Joshua and Tyson Fury. What's due is the Kubrat Pulev mandatory in June, and then the Alexander Usyk mandatory in probably November, December. Alexander Usyk is fighting Derek Chisora in May, and anything could happen in that fight. And if AJ vacates that WBO title, if he may have to fight Tyson Fury, it will be Usyk against Joseph Parker for the world title, which is a great fight. You know, Joseph Parker wants to become a two-time heavyweight champion of the world, and it's our job with his team to try and put him in those kind of fights. First things first, Sean Dell wins this tomorrow night. It's a fight that on paper, he should win and win well. In the heavyweight division, with two guys that can really punch, anything can happen. He's got to be switched on tomorrow night, get the win. I see Joseph Parker as a massive part of the heavyweight division in 2020.
Yeah, certainly former champion. A lot of people still fans of Joseph Parker. I want to ask you one more thing about Fury potentially against Anthony Joshua. I think a lot of media members and fans get tired of writing about the process and how things get derailed by the politics of boxing. Obviously, two different promoters involved, two different networks involved. How confident are you that if both sides want the fight and can make the fight, you can deliver the fight?
I think history will tell you, when there's so much money involved in fights, they naturally happen. You know, you had a fight with Fury and Wilder, you've got a guy in Bob Arum and Al Haymon that don't particularly like each other, that have been taking pot shots at each other time and time again. And every now and again, an amount of money presents itself where all of a sudden Bob Arum and Al Haymon become really good friends. And that can happen quite easily, and that can happen with the networks as well. You know, you've got the difference between with Fury and Joshua, with ESPN and DAZN, where you've got one pay-per-view model and another that's a subscription model, and these guys are going to have to sit down with themselves to work that out. It's our job to make the fight. I promise you, Anthony Joshua is desperate for this fight. I know Tyson Fury will accept this fight and this challenge. So I'm 100% sure this fight will get made. It's just a case of whether that's going to be this summer, but more likely in December 2020.
Joe, do you share the same confidence as Eddie? Of course, two different networks working together and work with Fox and ESPN. Can it work in this situation?
Absolutely. As we said all along, the devil's in the detail, but we have always been sort of doors open broadcaster. We're willing to get around a table with Eddie and the respective promoter on the other side and the other broadcaster and talk about how we might make that happen. And there's ways to make it happen. We're very open-minded on that, and we look forward to having those conversations.
All right, I want to turn it back to the main event we have here on Saturday. You got Mikey Garcia jumping up again at welterweight. Eddie, you have, I've said this, I've written this before. I mean, I've chased girls in high school less than you chased Mikey Garcia. Like, you were just all over him for a long period of time. You get
him. Difference is, I got that.
That's true. That's not a good number of years for me. But his decision to stay at welterweight, fighting this fight against Jesse Vargas, what do you think of it?
I just think Mikey Garcia is a guy that loves to be challenged. I mean, you know, I sat down with him, 2 years ago to try and, I was telling him about the zone. He was sort of looking at me like I was mad. What is this, you know, new idea that you've got? And as time went on, as the big fights landed, as the huge names joined the platform, he started to listen more, and eventually we got our guy. I think it's no secret that 140 pounds is the optimum weight for Mikey Garcia. The problem with Mikey Garcia is when you tell him it's not possible, he goes completely the other way. So when people tell him that he's not a welterweight and he can't become a five division world champion, he just wants to prove them wrong. This fight is a pure 50-50 fight, and the closer it gets, more people believing Jesse Vargas can win this fight. He's had the best camp ever. People worried about him coming back to 147. He has made the weight so well. He is so fired up, pumped up for this fight. And this fight is going to tell us everything we need to know about Mikey Garcia in the welterweight division. He lost to Errol Spence. He says things didn't work out then, no excuses, but he has his reasons. But let's see if he can actually go and win a welterweight world championship. If he can beat Jesse Vargas in style, I think there's an argument that he can become a world champion. But Jesse Vargas is so pumped for this fight. Such a wonderful fight. You know, Jesse told me at the start of this promotion that it would be like Morales against Barrera. I said, that's strong words, leave that for me to say. He said, I promise you, you're gonna get everything in this fight. I'm gonna put it all on the line. You've got a four division world champion against a two division world champion. We're gonna have over 10,000 in there tomorrow night. It's gonna be absolutely jumping. What a card, Yafai Chocolatito, Julio Cesar Martinez against Jay Harris. You know, this man here making his heavyweight return to the ring, Israel Madrimov in a world championship eliminator, Pacheco, Espino, and there's a lot of people who are calling Mikey Garcia's name. You know, this man here, he just wants the Garcia this year. Ryan or Mikey, he's not bothered. But, you know, I've made no secret that our preference, if Mikey Garcia would be triumphant, is to make that Manny Pacquiao fight in July.
Joe, one of the things that he's done with this fight, I think the Prograde Hooker fight as well, the depth of the card is really good. You know, this one is excellent. Are these the types of fights you want to see as the guy that stands there to approve them?
Absolutely, that was the commitment three years ago, I've got around the table and started talking about that, and that's what boxing in this country needs. There are arguably, there are too many cards being put together with only the main event of interest. It obviously helps ticket sales, it helps local ticket sales, and it helps us as a broadcaster give a 4 or 5 hour broadcast and gives you something to talk about live on air for a longer period of time than you otherwise would. So yeah, we're massively in support of that strategy. It's worked for Eddie tremendously in the UK. It helps people grow their profile. It gives reason for fans to come to the show early, and it gives us as a broadcast more to talk about, more to play with. So we're absolutely committed to that, and we look forward to continuing to invest in that with Eddie.
All right, Eddie mentioned Devin Haney and Mikey Garcia. You guys squared off a little bit earlier this month. What do you think of Mikey's decision to fight at 147? I mean, you know as well as anyone, they do make weight classes in boxing for a reason.
Well, yeah, they definitely make weight classes in boxing for a reason, but I feel like Mikey is daring to be great, and that's what it's all about. You know, he wants his name to be in the history books when it's all said and done, and these are the type of things that you need to do for that to happen.
So you come back this summer, if you have the option, just hypothetically, Mikey Garcia or Ryan Garcia, what's a more important fight to you?
That's a tough one. That's like Eddie said, just any Garcia, because both of those fights are huge. I would make a ton of money with either one of those fights. The fans would love to see them. Either one.
Your father said, in an argument that was against Bernard Hopkins after that Ryan Garcia fight, that you are headed to 140. Do you think that's going to happen in the near future?
The only fight that I would go up to 144 as of now is Mikey Garcia. There's so much, you know, great fights to be made at 135. It would make no sense for me to go up to 140 unless it was a Mikey Garcia type of fight.
So you're looking forward to defending your title and maybe getting it back against the winner of Luke Campbell, Javier Fortuna, which is also April 17th.
Most definitely.
All right, well, good luck to that, Devin. Joe, good luck to you tomorrow night. Eddie, Joe, thank you for being up here joining us. Everybody out there, thank you for listening for this period of time. And Saturday night, live on DAZN, Mikey Garcia, 147 pounds against Jesse Vargas.